Hello everyone. Continuing with the Indian Society series, and we are discussing the basic terms before we take up the main topic about women organizations. We have covered so far the concept of sex and gender, patriarchy, gender inequality, and today we'll be covering the basic term. Two basic terms. First is the violence against women and sex ratio. So these basic terms are very important because if you see the previous questions, the questions have been more about such basic term rather than being a direct question about women organization. And plus, these terms are very important because if you know the basic definition of these terms, the underlying causes or mechanics under these terms, like for example patriarchy or gender inequality, you can easily write a 10 marker or 15 marker question, and also it's very beneficial in the essay paper as well as in the GS2 paper, which in the social sector area of the GS2 exam paper. Now let's start with the topic, violence against women. Now, United Nations basically defines this term violence against women as any act of gender-based violence that results in or is likely to result in physical, sexual or mental harm or suffering to women. And this includes threat of such acts and coercion or arbitrary deprivation of liberty. So this is the definition. And the definitions of every word given in the syllabus as well as the related terms is very important, because not only it gives a fodder material to start your answer, but also it is very essential to form a framework of your answer. Okay, so now proceeding further, violence against women is a manifestation of historical unequal power relationship between women and men, and it has led to domination and discrimination against women. And basically, it is a social mechanism by which the subordinate position of the woman is perpetuated. Okay. Now, what are the causes which are responsible for the incidence of violence against women? First is the unequal power relation in the society. Now, we have discussed in the video about gender inequality and patriarchy. So these things lead to an unequal power relationship in a society, and these influences, this imbalance is perpetuated through use of violence. And likewise, the violence against women and girls is related to their lack of power and control. The inequalities between men and women, which cut across the public and private spheres of life, for example, in the public sphere, we have seen that there is glass ceiling and there is sexual division of labor, and in private sphere, women are mainly seen as secondary bread earners. Their main responsibility is with the household. And these are manifested in restrictions and limitations on women's freedom, choices, and opportunities. Now, how to reinforce this, the limitations and restrictions? It is by use of the violence. Now, second cause is the social norms prevalent in the society. Now, these social norms grant men a control over female behavior. Plus, there is the acceptance of violence as a way to resolve conflict. And there is a notion of masculinity, which is related to the dominance that perpetuate this violence against women. And plus, the women are taught to be submissive, and they have to honor the to take care of the honor of the family. So likewise, this increases the higher risk of violence against women. Now, thirdly, there are attitudes or practices that invisibilizes, minimizes, or even justify violence. For example, if in your neighborhood you hear voices frequent voices about, you know, the husband beating his wife, it is considered as a very private matter. Or there is often a belief, or, you know, there often people do not report incidents such as rape or molestation or harassment because it is seen as bringing shame to the family. The basically the female, the family honor is related to the female. So likewise, this attitude, it perpetuates, it helps to give a solid base to the violence against the notion of violence against the woman and makes the woman vulnerable. And thirdly, there is, we have already discussed about, you know, there are broader discriminating or gender stereotyping norms such as supporting male dominance. There is a male entitlement. And like, for example, there was a BBC video in which the rapist in the Nirbhaya case, they were interviewed. So their interview showed a kind of entitlement where they said, you know, the woman is roaming at around 10 at night. So, you know, it becomes our entitlement. She is not behaving in a normal manner. So that way their violence against her is justified. So this is a common notion because of the gender stereotyping norms. And it is often seen that, okay, the girl was harassed or she was raped because she was wearing certain kind of clothes. So these type of gender stereotyping, it, you know, provides a kind of legitimacy to the violence against women that, okay, the perpetrator would not be held responsible, but the woman against whom there is violence, she'll be held responsible for all the violence. So next point is, it's a repetition, I think it's a justification of male use of violence, and it's a belief that husbands have a right to physically discipline their wives under certain conditions, the placement of individual and female privacy and honor above the safety and well-being of girls and women. These all are responsible for violence against women. Okay. So concluding, these violence against women and girls is not only a consequence of gender inequality, but somehow it also reinforces women's low status in the society and gives rise to linked multiple disparities between women and men. Okay. Now discussing about the forms of violence against the woman. Now we can divide the violence against women in two forms. First are the manifest form. Manifest form means which are visible forms, and latent is which is not visible. Manifest in this we can include teasing, stalking, sexual harassment at work, voyeurism, molestation. You can check the Justice Verma committee, which was formed after the Nirbhaya incident. It has increased the number of these forms which gets included in the violence against women. And likewise, you know, other examples may be rape, dowry death, domestic violence, and commodification of women. So these are manifest form. Now Google up about these terms, what do all they mean, and any related concept. For example, with the sexual harassment at workplace, there is a bill and there is a Vishakha committee about that. So you can read Justice Verma committee's report. So these are very important things. So this is the manifest form. So whenever there is a question revolving around violence against women, it's always very good and better to have a structured answer like this. Like, the examiner will know, you know, you have a very clear view about this term. You know that there are certain manifest forms and there are certain hidden or latent forms of the violence against women. Okay, and then next is the latent form. If we talk about it, this is basically discrimination in food or health, education, employment. This is a symbolic form of structural violence. You know, many of you may think that this is not violence, but it is actually a symbolic form of structural violence against women, which further subordinate their position in the social stratification system and it hampers their growth. Okay, so these were the forms of violence against women. Now, the next topic, the term which we'll be discussing will be the sex ratio. Now, this is a very important topic. There has been around two questions in the since 2013 which have been revolving around sex ratio. And it's a very burning topic. Also, then there has been a scheme, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, which is centered around the child sex ratio. So this topic is very important, and we discuss the basic causes for low sex ratio and the other related terms. Okay. Now, sex ratio is basically the number of females per 1,000 males. Right now for India, it is around 940 females per 1,000 males. Now, the sex composition of the population is a very important key factor when we talk about countries' development, and it has both demographic as well as social implications in the society. Okay, so this is basically a graph depicting the sex ratio, which is 940, as well as child sex ratio, which is 914. Okay, so this graph or these numbers about sex ratio and child sex ratio is very important. Please learn in my heart. Now, we'll quickly go through the causes for low sex ratio in India. First, obviously, it is a social cultural attitude. There is deep-rooted patriarchy, as well as there is a notion of son preference. We've already discussed this in the previous videos, and we've discussed about, you know, why son is preferred in a society. First reason is the patrilocality. That is, the women often leave their paternal house after marriage, and the sons are remained back to take care of their parents. And because of this factor and this socio-cultural practice, there is a son preference in our society. Then second is the patrilineality. Now, the property of the family or the name of the family is carried out by the son. So this is another reason why sons are more preferred. Okay. And third is the dowry. Now, dowry is a kind of extra cost, you can say, which is attached with a girl child. This is the main reason why there is a son preference, because as soon as the girl is born, there is a increased, tension for the parents, like how we will marry her off, or how we will manage the dowry for her marriage. So this is another reason why sons are preferred more than the women. Then lastly is the old age support by the son. Now, the old age support system in a country are not well developed, and there is a social cultural practice that, you know, the son has to take care of his aged parents. So that is why also the son are preferred more. So this was the social cultural attitude which is mainly responsible for the low sex ratio in India. Then second is the technological factors. Now, with the advancement of science and certain techniques like ultrasound, it is possible to know about the sex of the child, and already there is son preference. So this has led to sex selective abortions, and so obviously there will be a low sex ratio, and the sex ratio will be favoring more the men. Thirdly, there are certain regional variations which are responsible for the low sex ratio in India. I want you to look at this table, and this is from my sociology notes basically, but you can have a quick look, and it basically gives a one picture why, you know, this is a north-south model of sex ratio, why, you know, the sex ratio is so skewed in North India. It states that, you know, in North India there is basically dry field plow cultivation. So basically for this, more of the men population are required, and there is exclusion of females from the production. So this leads to high cost of raising of several daughters, and And also there is high cost to the society to support so many non-workers. So that is why there is an intense preference of funds. Basically, this model has based its reason for segregation in the North India on the type of economic activity which takes place in that particular area. And South, it says that it's mainly a wooden and wet rice cultivation in which more of the female workers are involved. So, you know, they have, females have advantage in the society. So that is why there is appreciation for daughter, and it is a moderate preference for son. So it's not very essential that, okay, there has to be a son in the family. There is a moderate preference for the son. Okay, so this is a North-South model, which is one of the reasons, not entirely, you know, this is not the only reason. We have already discussed the socio-cultural attitude and the technological factors also. In North, I also want to add that after Green Revolution, there was increase in the prosperity of the population in this area. So they were more able to afford the sex selective abortion, as well as other facilities like ultrasound, and they were coming up of more of the hospitals in these areas. So basically, with the prosperity, you know, they were able to afford such practices. And also with Green Revolution, there came a more importance attached to the land. So for land, you need a son to carry. The patrilineality concept comes about. So in North, again, the preference for son was reiterated. Okay, so this is a term which has been, you know, used by a sociologist. You must have heard about Bimaru states, which is related to the socio-economic development of the low socio-economic developed states. But also there is a term which has been devised, Bimaru state, with respect to the low sex ratio. States like Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Gujarat. So it's turned out to be that, you know, Bimaru's full form is daughter eliminating male aspiring rage for ultrasound. So it's a very important term. If you use such key terms in your answer, it gives a very good impression and provides a very novelty to your answer. So you should try to use such factors. So these were some of the reasons for the regional variation. And also one factor is also there in the southern India, because of the more literacy level or the educational factor, they're more aware and they're more broad-minded. That is why also they have a kind of balanced sex ratio in the southern states. Then there is also an urban-rural gap, and sex ratio in the is tilted towards men in the urban area, because obviously there are more facilities for sex selective abortion available in the urban areas. And also, if you see the migration pattern in India, it is more skewed towards men. It is generally the men who first migrate, or not only first in the families, only the male members migrate to the urban area. So the sex ratio gets tilted towards the men. And then there are differences in the ST population. And for example, the child sex ratio is 957 per 1,000 males in the STs, whereas we have seen in the previous slides that it is around 914 for the national average. So you can see that it's a very good trend in the ST population. And around this figure, there was also a question in 2015 which asks about the reason, you know, why there is a better sex ratio in the ST population. So basic reason is that majority of the tribal areas, there is a kind of cultural gender parity rules in their respective tribes, and also there are certain matriarchal tribes also. Okay, so in, instead of patrilineality, there is matrilineality. And then also there is obviously lack of access to the prenatal diagnostic technology, which is easily available in the urban areas. There is not much knowledge about this also. Then there is no social bias against women in the tribal community, and which, you know, exists in the normal, in the general population or the middle class and caste. There are also very progressive rules among them. For example, women can ask for a divorce in many communities. And instead of dowry, there is a concept of bride price in these. So, you know, you see the socio-cultural practices basically lead to the inequality or the unequal power structure between men and women, which ultimately lead to the reason for the son preference. And obviously, then there is a practices like sex selective abortion, which in turn leads to a lower sex ratio. Okay, these were some of the reasons which are responsible for the low sex ratio in India. And this is a very important topic. Please do revise this. So with this video, we complete the basic terms related to the topic of women organization. In next video, I'll be finally discussing about the topic of women organizations, we'll cover also the in short we'll cover about the women movements also. It's a kind of overlapping topic, and there was also a question this year on women movements. So stay tuned. Thank you. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe to the channel. Thank you very much.